Section 1 of Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. Nathaniel Hawthorne, 1804 to 1864, by Henry James. It is perhaps an advantage in writing of Nathaniel Hawthorne's work that his life offers little opportunity to the biographer. The record of it makes so few exactions that in a critical account of him, even as brief as this, the work may easily take most of the place. He was one of those happy men of letters in whose course the great milestones are simply those of his ideas that found successful form. Born at Salem, Massachusetts, on July 4, 1804, of established local Puritan and a conspicuous degree sturdy seafaring stock, he was educated at his birthplace and at Bowdoin College, Maine, where H.W. Longfellow was one of his fellow students. Another was Franklin Pierce, who was to be elected President of the United States in 1852, and with whom Hawthorne formed relations that became an influence in his life. On leaving college in 1825, he returned to Salem to live, and in 1828 published in Boston a short romance called Fanshawe, of which the scene, in spite of its being a love story, is laid, but for a change of name, at Bowdoin, with professors and undergraduates for its male characters. The experiment was inevitably faint, but the author's beautiful touch had begun to feel its way. In 1837, after a dozen years spent in special solitude, as he later testified, at Salem, he collected as the first series of twice-told tales various more or less unremunerated contributions to the magazines and annuals of the day. In 1845 appeared the second series, and in 1851 the two volumes were, with a preface peculiarly graceful and touching, reissued together. He is in general never more graceful than when prefatory. In 1851 and 1854, respectively, came to light The Snow Image and Mosses from an Old Manse, which form, with the previous Devil's Sheaf, his three main gatherings in of the shorter fiction, I Neglect for Brevity, and as addressed to children, Grandfather's Chair and The Wonder Book, 1851, as well as Tanglewood Tales, 1852. Of the other groups, some preceded, some followed, the appearance in 1850 of his second novel, The Scarlet Letter. These things, the experiments in the shorter fiction, had sounded, with their rare felicity, from the very first the note that was to be Hawthorne's distinguished mark, that feeling for the latent romance of New England, which in summary form is the most final name to be given, I think, to his inspiration. This element, which is what, at its best, his genius most expresses, was far from obvious. It had to be looked for, and Hawthorne found it as he wandered and mused in the secret play of the Puritan faith. The secret, I say particularly, because the direct and ostensible face-to-face with common tasks and small conditions, as I may call them without prejudice to their general grimness, arrived at forms of which the tender imagination could make little. It could make a great deal, on the other hand, of the spiritual contortions, the darkened outlook, of the ingrained sense of sin, of evil, and of responsibility. There had been other complications in the history of the community surrounding him. Savages from behind, soldiers from before, a cruel climate from every quarter, and a pecuniary remittance from none. But the great complication was the pressing moral anxiety, the restless individual conscience. These things were developed at the cost of so many others that there were almost no others left to help them to make a picture for the artist. The artist's imagination had to deck out the subject to work it up, as we nowadays say, and Hawthorne's was, on intensely chastened lines, indeed equal to the task. In that manner it came into exercise from the first through the necessity of taking for granted on the part of the society about him a life of the spirit more complex than anything that met the mere eye of sense. It was a question of looking behind and beneath for the suggestive idea, the artistic motive, the effect of all of which was an invaluable training for the faculty that evokes and enhances. This ingenuity grew alert and irrepressive as it maneuvered for the back view and turned up the underside of common aspects, the laws secretly broken, the impulses secretly felt, the hidden passions, the double lives, the dark corners, the closed rooms, the skeletons in the cupboard, and at the feast. It made, in short, and cherished, for fancy's sake, a mystery and a glamour where there were otherwise none very ready to its hand, so that it ended by living in a world of things symbolic and allegoric. a presentation of objects casting, in every sense, far behind them, a shadow more curious and more amusing than the apparent figure. Any figure, therefore, easily became with him an emblem, any story a parable, any appearance a cover, things with which his concern is, gently, indulgently, skillfully, with the lightest hand in the world, to pivot them round and show the odd little stamp or sign that gives them their value for the collector. The specimens he collected, as we may call them, are divisible into groups, but with the mark in common that they are all early products of the dry New England air. Some are myths and mysteries of old Massachusetts, charming ghostly passages of colonial history. Such are the Great Champion, the Maypole of Marymount, the Four Beautiful Legends of the Province House. Others, like Roger Malvin's Burial, Rappaccini's Daughter, Young Goodman Brown, are moralities without the moral, as it were. Small cold apologues, frosty and exquisite, occasionally gathered from beyond the sea. Then there were the chapters of the fanciful, all for fancy's sake, of the pure whimsical, and of observation merely amused and beguiled. Pages, many of them, of friendly, humorous reflections on what, in Salem or in Boston, a dreamer might meet in his walks. What Hawthorne encountered, he instinctively embroidered, working it over with a fine, slow needle and with flowers, pale, rosy, or dusky, as the case might suggest. We have a handful of these in The Great Carbuncle and The Great Stone Face, The Seven Vagabonds, The Threefold Destiny, The Village Uncle, The Toll Gatherer's Day, A Rill from the Town Pump, and Chippings with a Chisel. The inequalities in his work are not, to my sense, great, and in specifying we take in leave with hesitation. The Scarlet Letter in 1850 brought him immediate distinction, and has probably kept its place not only as the most original of his novels, but as the most distinguished piece of prose fiction that was to spring from American soil. He had received in 1839 an appointment to a small place in the Boston Custom House, where his labors were sordid and sterile, and he had given it up in permissible weariness. He had spent in 1841 near Roxbury, Massachusetts, a few months in the cooperative community of Brook Farm, a short-lived socialistic experiment. He had married in the following year and gone to live at the old manse in Concord, where he remained till 1846, when, with a fresh fiscal engagement, he returned to his native town. It was in the intervals of his occupation at the Salem Custom House that The Scarlet Letter was written. The book has achieved the fortune of the small, supreme group of novels. It has hung an ineffaceable image in the portrait gallery, the reserved inner cabinet of literature. Hester Prynne is not one of those characters of fiction whom we use as a term of comparison for a character of fact. She is almost more than that. She decorates the museum in a way that seems to forbid us such a freedom. Hawthorne availed himself, for her history, of the most striking anecdote the early Puritan chronicle could give him. Give him in the manner set forth by the long, lazy prologue or introduction, an exquisite commemoration of the happy dullness of his term of service at the Custom House, where it is his fancy to pretend to have discovered in a box of old papers the faded relic and the musty documents which suggested to him his title and his theme. It is the story as old as the custom of marriage, the story of the husband, the wife, and the lover, but bathed in a misty, moonshiny light, and completely neglecting the usual sources of emotion. The wife, with the charming child of her guilt, has stood under the stern inquisitorial law in the public pillory of the adulteress, while the lover, a saintly young minister, undetected and unbetrayed, has in an anguish of pusillanimity suffered her to pay the whole fine. The husband, an ancient scholar, a man of abstruse and profane learning, finds his revenge years after the wrong in making himself insidiously the intimate of the young minister and feeding secretly on the remorse, the inward torments, which he does everything to quicken but pretends to have no ground for suspecting. The march of the drama lies almost wholly in the malignant pressure exercised in this manner by Chillingworth upon Dimmesdale, an influence that at last reaches its climax in the extraordinary penance of the subject who in the darkness, in the sleeping town, mounts himself upon the scaffold on which, years before, the partner of his guilt had undergone irrevocable anguish. And this situation he calls to him, Hester Prynne and her child, who, belated in the course of the merciful ministrations to which Hester has now given herself up, pass among the shadows within sight of him, and they, in response to his appeal, ascend for a second time to the place of atonement, and stand there with him under the cover of night. The scene is not complete, of course, till Chillingworth arrives to enjoy the spectacle and his triumph. It has inevitably gained great praise, and no page of Hawthorne's shows more intensity of imagination. Yet the main achievement of the book is not what is principally its subject, the picture of the relation of the two men. They are too faintly, the husband in particular, though so fancifully figured. The Scarlet Letter lives, in spite of too many cold concetti, Hawthorne's general danger, by something noble and truthful in the image of the branded mother and the beautiful child. Strangely enough, this pair are almost wholly outside the action, yet they preserve and vivify the work. The House of the Seven Gables, written during a residence of 2 years at Lenox, Massachusetts, was published in 1851. If there are probably no four books of any author among which, for a favorite, readers hesitate longer than between Hawthorne's four longest stories, there are at any rate many for whom this remains distinctly his largest and fullest production. Suffused as it is with a pleasant autumnal haze, it yet brushes more closely than its companions the surface of American life, comes a trifle nearer to being a novel of manners. The manners it shows us, indeed, are all interfused with the author's special tone, seen in a slanting afternoon light. Its detail and illustration are sufficiently copious, and I am tempted for my own part to pronounce the book, taking subject and treatment together, and in spite of the position, as a more concentrated classic enjoyed by The Scarlet Letter, the closest approach we are likely to have to the great work of fiction so often called for, that is to do us nationally most honor and most good. The subject reduced to its essence, indeed, accounts not quite altogether for all that there is in the picture. What there is besides is an extraordinary charm of expression, of sensibility, of humor, of touch. The question is that of the moral shrinkage of a family once uplifted, the last spasm of their starved gentility and flicker of their slow extinction. In the haunted world of Hawthorne's imagination, the old pension house, under its elm in the Salem by-street, is the place where the ghosts are most at home. Ghostly even are its actual tenants, the ancient virgin Hepzibah, with her turban, her scowl, her creaking joints, and her map of the great territory to the eastward belonging to her family, reduced in these dignities to selling profitless pennyworths over a counter. And the bewildered bachelor Clifford, released, like some blinking and noble déterré of the old Bastille, from 20 years of wrongful imprisonment, we meet at every turn with Hawthorne, his favorite fancy of communicated sorrows and inevitable atonements. Life is an experience in which we expiate the sins of others in the intervals of expiating our own. The heaviest visitation of the blighted pensions is the responsibility they have incurred through the misdeeds of a hard-hearted, witch-burning ancestor. This ancestor has an effective return to life in the person of the one actually robust and successful representation of the race, a bland, hard, showy, shallow ornament of the bench, a massive hypocrite and sensualist, who at last, though indeed too late, pays the penalty and removes the curse. The idea of the story is at once perhaps a trifle thin and a trifle obvious. The idea that races and individuals may die of mere dignity and heredity, and that they need for refreshment and cleansing to be, from without, breathed upon like dull mirrors. But the art of the thing is exquisite, its charm irresistible, its distinction complete. The House of the Seven Gables, I may add, contains, in the rich portrait of Judge Pynchon, a character more solidly suggested than, with the possible exception of the Zenobia of the Blithedale romance, any other figure in the author's list. Weary of Lenox, Hawthorne spent several months of 1852 at West Newton near Boston, where the Blithedale romance was brought forth. He made the most, for the food of fancy, of what came under his hand, happy in an appetite that could often find a feast in meager materials. The third of his novels is an echo, delightfully poetized, of his residence at Brook Farm. Transcendentalism was in those days in New England much in the air, and the most comprehensive account of the partakers of this quaint experiment appears to have been held to be that they were transcendentalists. More simply stated, there were young, candid radicals, reformers, philanthropists. The fact that it sprang, all irresponsibly indeed, from the observation of a known episode, gives the Blithedale romance also a certain value as a picture of manners. The place portrayed, however, opens quickly enough into the pleasantest and idlest dream world. Hawthorne, we gather, dreamed there more than he worked. He has traced his attitude delightfully in that of the fitful and ironical Coverdale, as to whom we wonder why he chose to rub shoulders quite so much. We think of him as drowsing on a hillside with his hat pulled over his eyes and the neighboring hum of reform turning in his ears to a refrain as vague as an old song. One thing is certain, that if he failed his companions as a laborer in the field, it was only that he might associate them with another sort of success. We feel, however, that he lets them off easily when we think of some of the queer figures and queer nostrums then abroad in the land, and which his mild satire, incurring none the less some mild reproach, fails to grind in its mill. The idea that he most tangibly presents is that of the unconscious way in which the search for the common good may cover 100 interested impulses and personal motives. The suggestion that such a company could only be bound together more by its delusions, its mutual suspicions and frictions, than by any successful surrender of self. The book contains two images of large and admirable intention, that of Hollingsworth, the heavy-handed radical, selfish and sincere, with no sense for jokes, for forms, or for shades, and that of Zenobia, the woman of sympathies, the passionate patroness of causes, who plays, as it were, with revolution and only encounters embarrassment. Zenobia is the most graceful of all portraits of the strong-minded of her sex, borrowing something of her grace, moreover, from the fate that was not to allow her to grow old and shrill, and not least touching from the air we attribute to her of looking with her fine imagination for adventures that were hardly, under the circumstances, to be met. We fill out the figure, perhaps, and even lend to the vision something more than Hawthorne intended. Zenobia was, like Coverdale himself, a subject of dreams that were not to find form at Roxbury. But Coverdale had other resources, while she had none but her final failure. Hawthorne indicates no more interesting aspect of the matter than her baffled effort to make a hero of Hollingsworth, who proves, to her misfortune, so much too inelastic for the part. All this, as we read it today, has a soft, shy glamour, a touch of the poetry, of far-off things. Nothing of the author's is a happier expression of what I have called his sense of the romance of New England. In 1853, Franklin Pierce, then president, appointed him consul at Liverpool, which was the beginning of a residence of some 7 years in England and in Italy, the period to which we owe the Marble Faun and Our Old Home. The material for the latter of these was the first to be gathered, but the appearance of the Marble Faun began in Rome in 1858, and finished during a second stay in England, preceded that of its companion. This is his only long drama on a foreign stage. Drawn from his own air, however, are much of its inspiration and its character. Hawthorne took with him to Italy, as he had done to England, more of the old Puritan consciousness than he left behind. The book has been consecrated as a kind of manual of Roman sights and impressions, brought together indeed in the light of a sympathy, always detached and often withheld. And its value is not diminished by its constant reference to an order of things of which, at present, the yearning pilgrim, before a board for the most part swept bare, can only pick up the crumbs. The mystical, the mythical are in the Marble Faun more than ever at hide-and-seek with the real. The author's fancy for freakish correspondences has its way, with Donatello's points of resemblance to the delightful statue in the Capitol. What he offers us is the history of a character, blissfully immature, awakening to manhood through the accidental, the almost unconscious, commission of a crime. For the happy youth before his act, the first complete act of his life, there have been no unanswered questions. But after it he finds himself confronted with all the weary questions of the world. This act consists of his ridding of an obscure tormentor, the obscurity is rather a mistake, a woman whom he loves, and who is older, cleverer, and more acquainted with life than himself. The humanizing, the moralizing of the Faun is again an ingenious conceit, but it has had for result to have made the subject of the process, and the case is unique in Hawthorne's work, one of those creations of the storyteller who give us a name for a type. There is a kind of young man whom we have now only to call a Donatello, to feel that we sufficiently classify him. It is a part of the scheme of the story to extend a still another nature than his the same sad intuition. A young woman from across the Atlantic, a gentle copyist in Roman galleries of still gentler Guidos and Guicernos, happens to have caught a glimpse, at the critical moment, of the dismal secret that unites Donatello and Miriam. This for her is the tree of bitter knowledge, the taste of which sickens and saddens her. The burden is more than she can bear, and one of the most charming passages in the book describes how at last, at a summer's end, in sultry solitude, She stops at St. Peter's before a confessional, and Protestant and Puritan as she is, yields to the necessity of kneeling there and ridding herself of her obsession. Hawthorne's young women are exquisite. Hilda is a happy sister to the Phoebe of the House of the Seven Gables and the Priscilla of the Blithedale Romance. The drama in the Marble Faun, nonetheless, I think, is of an effect less complete than that of the almost larger element that I can only call the landscape and the spirit. Nothing is more striking than the awkward grace with which the author utters, without consenting to it, for he is full of half-amiable, half-angry protest and prejudice, the message, the mystery of the medium in which his actors move. Miriam and her muffled bandit have faded away, and we have our doubts and even our fears about Kenyon and his American statuary. But the breath of old Rome, the scents of old Italy, still meet us as we turn the page, and the book will long, on the great sentimental journey, continue to peep out of most pockets. He returned to America in 1860, settled once more at Concord, and died at Plymouth, New Hampshire, in the arms of Franklin Pierce in 1864. At home, with the aid of many memories and of the copious diaries ultimately published by his wife and children, he brought forth, one by one, the chapters eventually collected under the title of Our Old Home. The American notebooks of the English and the French and Italian were given to the world after his death, in 1868, 1870, and 1871, respectively. And if I add to these the small campaign Life of Franklin Pierce, 1852, two posthumous fragments, Septimus Felton and the Dolliver Romance, and those scraps and shreds of which his table drawers were still more exhaustively emptied, his literary catalog, none of the longest, becomes complete. The important item in this remainder is the close, ripe cluster, the series presented by himself of his impressions of England. The admirable papers, with much of the same fascination, have something of the same uncomforted note with which he had surrendered himself to the charm of Italy. The mixture of sensibility and reluctance, of response and dissent, the strife between his sense of beauty and his sense of banishment. He came to the old world late in life, though after dabbling for years, indeed, in the fancied phenomena of time, and with inevitable reserves, mistrust, and antagonisms. The striking thing to my sense, however, is not what he missed, but what he so ingeniously and vividly made out. If he had been, imaginatively, rather old in his youth, he was youthful in his age, and when all is said, we owe him, as a contribution to the immemorial process of lively repartee between the motherland and the daughter, the only pages of the business that can be said to belong to literature. He was capable of writing the Marble Faun, and yet of declaring, in a letter from Rome, that he bitterly detested the place and should rejoice to bid it farewell forever. Just so, he was capable of drawing from English aspects a delight that they had yielded not even to Washington Irving, and yet of insisting, with a perversity that both smiled and frowned, that they rubbed him mainly all the wrong way. At home he had fingered the musty, but abroad he seemed to pine for freshness. In truth, for many persons, his great, his most touching sign will have been his aloofness wherever he is. He is outside of everything and an alien everywhere. He is an aesthetic solitary. His beautiful, light imagination is the wing that on the autumn evening just brushes the dusky window. It was a faculty that gave him much more a terrible sense of human abysses than a desire rashly to sound them and rise to the surface with his report. On the surface of the soul, and the edge of the tragedy, he preferred to remain. He lingered to weave his web in a thin exterior air. This is the partial expression of his characteristic habit of dipping, of diving, just for sport, into the moral world without being in the least a moralist. He had none of the heat nor of the dogmatism of that character, none of the impertinence, as we feel he would almost have held it, of any intermeddling. He never intermeddled. He was divertedly and discreetly contemplative, pausing oftenest wherever, amid prosaic aspects, there seemed most of an appeal to a sense of subtleties. But of all cynics, he was the brightest and kindest, and the subtleties he spun are more silken threads for stringing polished beads. His collection of moral mysteries is the cabinet of a dilettante. End of section one. Section 2 of Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. Selected excerpts from The Scarlet Letter by Nathaniel Hawthorne, Part 1. Salem and the Hawthornes. This old town of Salem, my native place, though I have dwelt much away from it, both in boyhood and maturer years, possesses or did possess a hold on my affections, the force of which I have never realized during my seasons of actual residence here. Indeed, so far as its physical aspect is concerned, with its flat, unvaried surface covered chiefly with wooden houses, few or none of which pretend to architectural beauty, its irregularity, which is neither picturesque nor quaint, but only tame, its long and lazy street lounging wearisomely through the whole extent of the peninsula, with Gallows Hill and New Guinea at one end, and a view of the almshouse at the other, such being the features of my native town, it would be quite as reasonable to form a sentimental attachment to a disarranged checkerboard. And yet, though invariably happiest elsewhere, there is within me a feeling for Old Salem which, in lack of a better phrase, I must be content to call affection. The sentiment is probably assignable to the deep and aged roots which my family has struck into the soil. It is now nearly 2 centuries and a quarter since the original Briton, the eldest immigrant of my name, made his appearance in the wild and forest-bordered settlement which has since become a city, and here his descendants have been born and died, and have mingled their earthly substance with the soil, until no small portion of it must necessarily be akin to the mortal frame wherewith, for a little while, I walk the streets. In part, therefore, the attachment which I speak of is the mere sensuous sympathy of dust for dust. Few of my countrymen can know what it is, nor as frequent transplantation is perhaps better for the stock, need they consider it desirable to know. But the sentiment has likewise its moral quality. The figure of that first ancestor, invested by family tradition with a dim and dusky grandeur, was present to my boyish imagination as far back as I can remember. It still haunts me and induces a sort of home feeling with the past, which I scarcely claim in reference to the present phase of the town. I seem to have a stronger claim to a residence here on account of this grave, bearded, sable-cloaked, and steeple-crowned progenitor, who came so early with his Bible and his sword, and trod the unworn street with such a stately port, and made so large a figure as a man of war and peace, a stronger claim than for myself, whose name is seldom heard, and my face hardly known. He was a soldier, legislator, judge. He was a ruler in the church. He had all the puritanic traits, both good and evil. He was likewise a bitter persecutor, as witness the Quakers, who have remembered him in their histories and relate an incident of his hard severity towards a woman of their sect, which will last longer, it is to be feared, than any record of his better deeds, although these were many. His son, too, inherited the persecuting spirit, and made himself so conspicuous in the martyrdom of the witches, that their blood may fairly be said to have left a stain upon him. So deep a stain, indeed, that his old dry bones and the Charter Street burial ground must still retain it, if they have not crumbled utterly to dust. I know not whether these ancestors of mine bethought themselves to repent and ask pardon of heaven for their cruelties, or whether they are now groaning under the heavy consequences of them in another state of being. At all events, I, the present writer, as their representative, hereby take shame upon myself for their sakes, and pray that any curse incurred by them, as I have heard, and as the dreary and unprosperous condition of the race for many a long year back would argue to exist, may be now and henceforth removed. Doubtless, however, either of these stern and black-browed Puritans would have thought it quite a sufficient retribution for his sins that, after so long a lapse of years, the old trunk of the family tree, with so much venerable moss upon it, should have borne as its topmost bough an idler like myself. No aim that I have ever cherished would they recognize as laudable. No success of mine, if my life, beyond its domestic scope, had ever been brightened by success, would they deem otherwise than worthless, if not positively disgraceful. "What is he?" murmurs one gray shadow of my forefathers to the other. "A writer of storybooks. What kind of a business in life, what mode of glorifying God or being serviceable to mankind in his day and generation, may that be? Why, the degenerate fellow might as well have been a fiddler." Such are the compliments bandied between my great-grandsires and myself across the gulf of time. And yet, let them scorn me as they will, strong traits of their nature have intertwined themselves with mine. planted deep in the town's earliest infancy and childhood by these two earnest and energetic men, the race has ever since subsisted here. Always, too, in respectability, never, so far as I have known, disgraced by a single unworthy member. But seldom or never, on the other hand, after the first two generations, performing any memorable deed, or so much as putting forward a claim to public notice. Gradually they have sunk almost out of sight, as old houses here and there about the streets get covered halfway to the eaves by the accumulation of new soil. From father to son, for above 100 years, they followed the sea, a gray-headed shipmaster in each generation retiring from the quarter-deck to the homestead, while a boy of 14 took the hereditary place before the mast, confronting the salt spray and the gale, which had blustered against his sire and grandsire. The boy also, in due time, passed from the forecastle to the cabin, spent a tempestuous manhood, and returned from his world wanderings to grow old and die and mingle his dust with the natal earth. This long connection of a family with one spot, as its place of birth and burial, creates a kindred between the human being and the locality, quite independent of any charm in the scenery or moral circumstances that surround him. It is not love, but instinct. The new inhabitant, who came himself from a foreign land, or whose father or grandfather came, has little claim to be called a Salemite. He has no conception of the oyster-like tenacity with which an old settler, over whom his third century is creeping, clings to the spot where his successive generations have been embedded. It is no matter that the place is joyless for him, that he is weary of the old wooden houses, the mud and dust, the dead level of sight and sentiment, the chill east wind, and the chillest of social atmospheres. All these and whatever faults besides he may see or imagine are nothing to the purpose. The spell survives, and just as powerfully as if the natal spot were an earthly paradise. So has it been in my case. I felt it almost as a destiny to make Salem my home, so that the mold of features and cast of character, which had all along been familiar here, ever as one representative of the race lay down in his grave, another assuming, as it were, his sentry march along the main street, might still in my little day be seen and recognized in the old town. Nevertheless, this very sentiment is an evidence that the connection, which has become an unhealthy one, should at last be severed. Human nature will not flourish any more than a potato if it be planted and replanted for too long a series of generations in the same worn-out soil. My children have had other birthplaces, and so far as their fortunes may be within my control, shall strike their roots into unaccustomed earth. The Minister's Vigil. Shortly afterwards, the light grisly sense of the humorous again stole in among the solemn phantoms of his thought. He felt his limbs growing stiff with the unaccustomed chilliness of the night, and doubted whether he should be able to descend the steps of the scaffold. Morning would break and find him there. The neighborhood would begin to rouse itself. The earliest riser, coming forth in the dim twilight, would perceive a vaguely defined figure aloft on the place of shame, and half-crazed betwixt alarm and curiosity, would go knocking from door to door, summoning all the people to behold the ghost, as he needs must think it, of some defunct transgressor. A dusky tumult would flap its wings from one house to another. Then the morning light, still waxing stronger, old patriarchs would rise up in great haste, each in his flannel gown, and matronly dames, without pausing, to put off their night gear. The whole tribe of decorous personages, who had never heretofore been seen with a single hair of their heads awry, would start into public view with the disorder of a nightmare in their aspects. Old Governor Bellingham would come grimly forth with his King James ruff fastened askew, and Mistress Hibbins, with some twigs of the forest clinging to her skirts, and looking sourer than ever, as having hardly got a wink of sleep after her night ride, and good Father Wilson, too, after spending half the night at a deathbed, and looking ill to be disturbed thus, early out of his dreams about the glorified saints. Hither likewise will come the elders and deacons of Mr. Dimmesdale's church, and the young virgins who so idolized their minister, and had made a shrine for him in their white bosoms, which now, by the by, in their hurry and confusion, they would scantily have given themselves time to cover with their kerchiefs. All people, in a word, would come stumbling over their thresholds, and turning up their amazed and horror-stricken visages around the scaffold. Whom would they discern there, with the red eastern light upon his brow. Whom but the Reverend Arthur Dimmesdale, half frozen to death, overwhelmed with shame, and standing where Hester Prynne had stood. Carried away by the grotesque horror of this picture, the minister, unawares, and to his own infinite alarm, burst into a great peal of laughter. It was immediately responded to by a light, airy, childish laugh, in which were the thrill of the heart, but he knew not whether of exquisite pain or pleasure as acute. He recognized the tones of Little Pearl. "Pearl! Little Pearl!" cried he after a moment's pause, then suppressing his voice. "Hester! Hester Prynne, are you there?" "Yes, it is Hester Prynne," she replied, in a tone of surprise, and the minister heard her footsteps approaching from the sidewalk, along which she had been passing. "It is I and my little Pearl." "Whence come you, Hester?" asked the minister. "What sent you hither?" "I have been watching at a deathbed," answered Hester Prynne, "at Governor Winthrop's deathbed, and have taken his measure for a robe, and am now going homeward to my dwelling." "Come up hither, Hester, thou and little Pearl," said the Reverend Mr. Dimmesdale. "You have both been here before, but I was not with you. Come up hither once again, and we will stand all three together." She silently ascended the steps and stood on the platform, holding little Pearl by the hand. The minister felt for the child's other hand and took it. The moment that he did so, there came what seemed a tumultuous rush of new life, other life than his own, pouring like a torrent into his heart and hurrying through all his veins, as if the mother and child were communicating their vital warmth to his half-torpid system. The three formed an electric chain. "Minister," whispered little Pearl. "What wouldst thou say, child?" asked Mr. Dimmesdale. "Wilt thou stand here with my mother and me tomorrow noontide?" inquired Pearl. "Nay, not so, my little Pearl," answered the minister. For with the new energy of the moment, all the dread of public exposure that had so long been the anguish of his life had returned upon him, and he was already trembling at the conjunction in which, with the strange joy nonetheless, he now found himself. "Not so, my child. I shall indeed stand with thy mother and thee one other day, but not tomorrow." Pearl laughed and attempted to pull away her hand, but the minister held it fast. "A moment longer, my child," said he. "But wilt thou promise," asked Pearl, "to take my hand and mother's hand tomorrow noontide?" "Not then, Pearl," said the minister, "but another time." "And what other time?" persisted the child. "At the great judgment day," whispered the minister. And strangely enough, the sense that he was a professional teacher of the truth impelled him to answer the child so. "Then and there, before the judgment seat, thy mother and thou and I must stand together. But the daylight of this world shall not see our meeting." Pearl laughed again. But before Mr. Dimmesdale had done speaking, a light gleamed far and wide over all the muffled sky. It was doubtless caused by one of those meteors which the night watcher may so often observe, burning out to waste in the vacant regions of the atmosphere. So powerful was its radiance that it thoroughly illuminated the dense medium of cloud betwixt the sky and earth. The great vault brightened, like the dome of an immense lamp. It showed the familiar scene of the street with the distinctness of midday, but also with the awfulness that is always imparted to familiar objects by an unaccustomed light. The wooden houses with their jutting stories and quaint gable peaks, the doorsteps and thresholds with the early grass springing up about them, the garden plots, black with freshly turned earth, the wheel track little worn, and even in the marketplace margined with green on either side, all were visible, but with a singularity of aspect that seemed to give another moral interpretation to the things of this world than they had ever borne before. And there stood the minister with his hand over his heart, and Hester Prynne with the embroidered letter glittering on her bosom, and little Pearl, herself a symbol, and the connecting line between those two. They stood in the noon of that strange and solemn splendor, as if it were the light that is to reveal all secrets, and the daybreak that shall unite all who belong to one another. End of section 2. Section 3 of Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. Selected Excerpts from the Scarlet Letter by Nathaniel Hawthorne, Part 2. The Child at the Brookside. "Thou wilt love her dearly," repeated Hester Prynne, as she and the minister sat watching little Pearl. "Dost thou not think her beautiful? And see with what natural skill she has made those simple flowers adorn her. Had she gathered pearls and diamonds and rubies in the wood, they could not have become her better. She is a splendid child, but I know whose brow she has." "Dost thou know, Hester," said Arthur Dimmesdale with an unquiet smile, "that this dear child, tripping about always at thy side, hath caused me many an alarm? Methought, O Hester, what a thought is that, and how terrible to dread it, that my own features were partly repeated in her face, and so strikingly that the world might see them. But she is mostly thine." "No, no, not mostly," answered the mother with a tender smile. "A little longer, and thou needest not to be afraid to trace whose child she is. But how strangely beautiful she looks, with those wild flowers in her hair. It is as if one of the fairies whom we left in our dear old England had decked her out to meet us." It was with a feeling which neither of them had ever before experienced that they sat and watched Pearl's slow advance. In her was visible the tie that united them. She had been offered to the world, these 7 years past, as the living hieroglyphic in which was revealed the secret they so darkly sought to hide. All written in this symbol, all plainly manifest, had there been a prophet or magician skilled to read the character of flame. And Pearl was the oneness of their being. Be the foregone evil what it might, how could they doubt that their earthly lives and future destinies were conjoined when they beheld at once the material union and the spiritual idea in whom they met and were to dwell immortally together? Thoughts like these, and perhaps other thoughts, which they did not acknowledge or define, threw an awe about the child as she came onward. "Let her see nothing strange, no passion nor eagerness, in thy way of accosting her," whispered Hester. "Our Pearl is a fitful and fantastic little elf sometimes. Especially she is seldom tolerant of emotion, when she does not fully comprehend the why and wherefore. But the child hath strong affections. She loves me and will love thee." "Thou canst not think," said the minister, glancing aside at Hester Prynne, "how my heart dreads this interview and yearns for it. But in truth, as I already told thee, children are not readily won to be familiar with me. They will not climb my knee, nor prattle in my ear, nor answer to my smile, but stand apart and eye me strangely. Even little babes, when I take them in my arms, weep bitterly. Yet Pearl, twice in her little lifetime, hath been kind to me. The first time, thou knowest it well. The last was when thou ledst her with thee to the house of yonder stern old governor. And thou didst plead so bravely in her behalf and mine," answered the mother. "I remember it, and so shall little Pearl. Fear nothing, she may be strange and shy at first, but will soon learn to love thee." By this time Pearl had reached the margin of the brook, and stood on the farther side gazing silently at Hester and the clergyman, who still sat together on the mossy tree trunk waiting to receive her. Just where she had paused, the brook chanced to form a pool so smooth and quiet that it reflected a perfect image of her little figure, with all the brilliant picturesqueness of her beauty, and its adornment of flowers and wreathed foliage, but more refined and spiritualized than the reality. This image, so nearly identical with the living Pearl, seemed to communicate somewhat of its own shadowy and intangible quality to the child herself. It was strange, the way in which Pearl stood looking so steadfastly at them through the dim medium of the forest gloom, herself meanwhile all glorified with a ray of sunshine that was attracted thitherward as by a certain sympathy. In the brook beneath stood another child, another in the same, with likewise its ray of golden light. Hester felt herself in some indistinct and tantalizing manner estranged from Pearl, as if the child, in her lonely ramble through the forest, had strayed out of the sphere in which she and her mother dwelt together, and was now vainly seeking to return to it. There was both truth and error in the impression. The child and mother were estranged, but through Hester's fault, not Pearl's. Since the latter rambled from her side, another inmate had been admitted within the circle of the mother's feelings, and so modified the aspect of them all that Pearl, the returning wanderer, could not find her wonted place, and hardly knew where she was. "I have a strange fancy," observed the sensitive minister, "that this brook is the boundary between two worlds, and that thou canst never meet thy Pearl again. Or is she an elfish spirit, who, as the legends of our childhood taught us, is forbidden to cross a running stream. Pray hasten her, for this delay has already imparted a tremor to my nerves. Come, dearest child, said Hester encouragingly, and stretching out both her arms. How slow thou art! When hast thou been so sluggish before now? Here is a friend of mine, who must be thy friend also. Thou wilt have twice as much love henceforward as thy mother alone could give thee. Leap across the brook and come to us. Thou canst leap like a young deer. Pearl, without responding in any manner to these honey-sweet expressions, remained on the other side of the brook. Now she fixed her bright, wild eyes on her mother, now on the minister, and now included them both in the same glance, as if to detect and explain to herself the relation which they bore to one another. For some unaccountable reason, as Arthur Dimmesdale felt the child's eyes upon himself, his hand, with that gesture so habitual as to have become involuntary, stole over his heart. At length, assuming a singular air of authority, Pearl stretched out her hand, with the small forefinger extended and pointing evidently towards her mother's breast, and beneath, in the mirror of the brook, there was the flower-girdled and sunny image of little Pearl, pointing her small forefinger too. "Thou strange child, why dost thou not come to me?" exclaimed Hester. Pearl still pointed with her forefinger, and a frown gathered on her brow, the more impressive from the childish, the almost baby-like aspect of the features that conveyed it, as her mother still kept beckoning to her and arraying her face in a holiday suit of unaccustomed smiles. The child stamped her foot with a yet more imperious look and gesture. In the brook again was the fantastic beauty of the image, with its reflected frown, its pointed finger, and imperious gesture, giving emphasis to the aspect of little Pearl. "Hasten, Pearl, or I shall be angry with thee," cried Hester Prynne, who, however inured to such behavior on the elf child's part at other seasons, was naturally anxious for a more seemly deportment now. "Leap across the brook, naughty child, and run hither, else I must come to thee." But Pearl, not a whit startled at her mother's threats any more than mollified by her entreaties, now suddenly burst into a fit of passion, gesticulating violently and throwing her small figure into the most extravagant contortions. She accompanied this wild outbreak with piercing shrieks, which the woods reverberated on all sides, so that, alone as she was in her childish and unreasonable wrath, it seemed as if a hidden multitude were lending her their sympathy and encouragement. Seen in the brook once more was the shadowy wraith of Pearl's image, crowned and girdled with flowers, but stamping its foot, wildly gesticulating, and in the midst of all, still pointing its small forefinger at Hester's bosom. "I see what ails the child," whispered Hester to the clergyman, and turning pale in spite of a strong effort to conceal her trouble and annoyance. "Children will not abide any, the slightest, change in the accustomed aspect of things that are daily before their eyes. Pearl misses something which she has always seen me wear." "I pray you," answered the minister, "if thou hast any means of pacifying the child, do it forthwith, save it were the cankered wrath of an old witch like Mistress Hibbins," added he, attempting to smile. "I know nothing that I would not sooner encounter than this passion in a child. In Pearl's young beauty, as in the wrinkled witch, it has a preternatural effect. Pacify her, if thou lovest me." Hester turned again towards Pearl with a crimson blush upon her cheek, a conscious glance aside at the clergyman, and then a heavy sigh, while even before she had time to speak, the blush yielded to a deadly pallor. "Pearl," said she sadly, "look down at thy feet, there before thee on the hither side of the brook." The child turned her eyes to the point indicated, and there lay the scarlet letter, so close upon the margin of the stream that the gold embroidery was reflected in it. "Bring it hither," said Hester. "Come thou and take it up," answered Pearl. "Was ever such a child?" observed Hester, aside to the minister. "Oh, I have much to tell thee about her, but in very truth she is right as regards this hateful token. I must bear its torture yet a little longer, only a few days longer, until we shall have left this region, and look back hither, as to a land which we have dreamed of. The forest cannot hide it. The mid-ocean shall take it from my hand and swallow it up forever." With these words she advanced to the margin of the brook, took up the scarlet letter, and fastened it again into her bosom. Hopefully but a moment ago, as Hester had spoken of drowning it in the deep sea, there was a sense of inevitable doom upon her, as she thus received back this deadly symbol from the hand of fate. She had flung it into infinite space. She had drawn an hour's free breath, and here again was the scarlet misery, glittering on the old spot. So it ever is, whether thus typified or no, that an evil deed invests itself with the character of doom. Hester next gathered up the heavy tresses of her hair, and confined them beneath her cap. As if there was a withering spell in the sad letter, her beauty, the warmth and richness of her womanhood, departed like fading sunshine, and a gray shadow seemed to fall across her. When the dreary change was wrought, she extended her hand to Pearl. "Dost thou know thy mother now, child?" asked she reproachfully, but with a subdued tone. "Wilt thou come across the brook and own thy mother? Now she has her shame upon her, now that she is sad." "Yes, now I will," answered the child, bounding across the brook and clasping Hester in her arms. "Now thou art my mother indeed, and I am thy little Pearl." In a mood of tenderness that was not usual with her, she drew down her mother's head and kissed her brow and both her cheeks. But then, by a kind of necessity that always impelled this child to alloy whatever comfort she might chance to give with a throb of anguish, Pearl put up her mouth and kissed the scarlet letter, too. "That was not kind," said Hester. "When thou hast shown me a little love, thou mockest me." "Why doth the minister sit yonder?" asked Pearl. "He waits to welcome thee," replied her mother. "Come thou and entreat his blessing. He loves thee, my little Pearl, and loves thy mother, too. Wilt thou not love him? Come, he longs to greet thee." "Doth he love us?" said Pearl, looking up with acute intelligence into her mother's face. "Will he go back with us, hand in hand, we three together, into the town?" "Not now, my dear child," answered Hester. "But in days to come he will walk hand in hand with us. We will have a home and fireside of our own, and thou shalt sit upon his knee, and he will teach thee many things and love thee dearly. Thou wilt love him, wilt thou not?" "And will he always keep his hand over his heart?" inquired Pearl. "Foolish child, what question is that?" exclaimed her mother. "Come and ask his blessing." But whether influenced by the jealousy that seems instinctive with every petted child towards a dangerous rival, or from whatever caprice of her freakish nature, Pearl would show no favor to the clergyman. It was only by an exertion of force that her mother brought her up to him, hanging back and manifesting her reluctance by odd grimaces, of which, ever since her babyhood, she had possessed a singular variety, and could transform her mobile physiognomy into a series of different aspects, with a new mischief in them, each and all. The minister, painfully embarrassed, but hoping that a kiss might prove a talisman to admit him into the child's kindlier regards, bent forward and impressed one on her brow. Hereupon Pearl broke away from her mother, and running to the brook, stooped over it and bathed her forehead until the unwelcome kiss was quite washed off and diffused through a long lapse of the gliding water. She then remained apart, silently watching Hester and the clergyman, while they talked together and made such arrangements as were suggested by their new position, and the purposes soon to be fulfilled. And now this fateful interview had come to a close. The dell was to be left a solitude among its dark old trees, which, with their multitudinous tongues, would whisper long of what had passed there, and no mortal be the wiser. And the melancholy brook would add this other tale to the mystery with which its little heart was already overburdened, and whereof it still kept up a murmuring babble, with not a whit more cheerfulness of tone than for ages heretofore. The Revelation of the Scarlet Letter. The eloquent voice, on which the souls of the listening audience had been borne aloft as on the swelling waves of the sea, at length came to a pause. There was a momentary silence, profound as what should follow the utterance of oracles. Then ensued a murmur and half-hushed tumult, as if the auditors, released from the high spell that had transported them into the region of another's mind, were returning into themselves, with all their awe and wonder still heavy on them. In a moment more the crowd began to gush forth from the doors of the church. Now that there was an end, they needed other breath, more fit to support the gross and earthly life into which they relapsed, than that atmosphere which the preacher had converted into words of flame and had burdened with the rich fragrance of his thought. In the open air their rapture broke into speech. The street and the marketplace absolutely babbled from side to side with applauses of the minister. His hearers could not rest until they had told one another of what each knew better than he could tell or hear. According to their united testimony, Never had man spoken in so wise, so high, and so holy a spirit as he that spake this day. Nor had inspiration ever breathed through mortal lips more evidently than it did through his. Its influence could be seen, as it were, descending upon him and possessing him, and continually lifting him out of the written discourse that lay before him, and filling him with ideas that must have been as marvelous to himself as to his audience. His subject, it appeared, had been the relation between the deity and the communities of mankind, with a special reference to the New England, which they were here planting in the wilderness. And as he drew towards the close, a spirit as of prophecy had come upon him, constraining him to its purpose as mightily as the old prophets of Israel were constrained. Only with this difference, that whereas the Jewish seers had denounced judgments and ruin on their country, it was his mission to foretell a high and glorious destiny for the newly gathered people of the Lord. But throughout it all, and through the whole discourse, there had been a certain deep, sad undertone of pathos, which could not be interpreted otherwise than as the natural regret of one soon to pass away. Yes, their minister whom they so loved, and who so loved them all that he could not depart heavenward without a sigh, had the foreboding of untimely death upon him, and would soon leave them in their tears. This idea of his transitory stay on earth gave the last emphasis to the effect which the preacher had produced. It was as if an angel in his passage to the skies had shaken his bright wings over the people for an instant, at once a shadow and a splendor, and had shed down a shower of golden truths upon them. Thus there had come to the Reverend Mr. Dimmesdale, as to most men in their various spheres, though seldom recognized until they see it far behind them, an epoch of life more brilliant and full of triumph than any previous one, or than any which could hereafter be. He stood at this moment on the very proudest eminence of superiority to which the gifts of intellect, rich lore, prevailing eloquence, and a reputation of widest sanctity could exalt a clergyman in New England's earliest days, when the professional character was of itself a lofty pedestal. Such was the position which the minister occupied as he bowed his head forward on the cushions of the pulpit at the close of his election sermon. Meanwhile, Hester Prynne was standing beside the scaffold of the pillory, with the scarlet letter still burning on her breast. Now was heard again the clangor of the music, and the measured tramp of the military escort issuing from the church door. The procession was to be marshaled thence to the town hall, where a solemn banquet would complete the ceremonies of the day. Once more, therefore, the train of venerable and majestic fathers was seen moving through a broad pathway of the people, who drew back reverently on either side, as the governor and magistrates, the old and wise men, the holy ministers, and all that were eminent and renowned, advanced into the midst of them. When they were fairly in the marketplace, their presence was greeted by a shout. This, though doubtless it might acquire additional force and volume from the childlike loyalty which the age awarded to its rulers, was felt to be an irrepressible outburst of enthusiasm, kindled in the auditors by that high strain of eloquence which was yet reverberating in their ears. Each felt the impulse in himself, and in the same breath caught it from his neighbor. Within the church it had hardly been kept down. Beneath the sky it peeled upward to its zenith. There were human beings enough, and enough of highly wrought and symphonious feeling, too, produced that more impressive sound than the organ tones of the blast, or the thunder, or the roar of the sea. Even that mighty swell of many voices, blended into one great voice by the universal impulse which makes likewise one vast heart out of the many. Never from the soil of New England had gone up such a shout. Never on New England's soil had stood the man so honored by his mortal brethren as the preacher. How fared it with him, then? Were there not the brilliant particles of a halo in the air about his head? So etherealized by spirit as he was, and so apotheosized by worshipping admirers, did his footsteps in the procession really tread upon the dust of earth? As the ranks of military men and civil fathers moved onward, all eyes were turned towards the point where the minister was seen to approach among them. The shout died into a murmur, as one portion of the crowd after another obtained a glimpse of him. How feeble and pale he looked, amid all his triumph. The energy, or say rather the inspiration, which had held him up until he should have delivered the sacred message that brought its own strength along with it from heaven, was withdrawn now, that it had so faithfully performed its office. The glow which they had just before beheld burning on his cheek was extinguished, like a flame that sinks down hopelessly among the late decaying embers. It seemed hardly the face of a man alive with such a death-like hue. It was hardly a man with life in him that tottered on his path so nervelessly, yet tottered and did not fall. One of his clerical brethren, it was the venerable John Wilson, observed the state in which Mr. Dimmesdale was left by the retiring wave of intellect and sensibility, stepped forward hastily to offer his support. The minister tremulously, but decidedly, repelled the old man's arm. He still walked onward, if that movement could be so described, which rather resembled the wavering effort of an infant, with its mother's arms in view outstretched to tempt him forward. And now, almost imperceptible as were the latter steps of his progress, he had come opposite the well-remembered and weather-darkened scaffold, where long since, with all that dreary lapse of time between, Hester Prynne had encountered the world's ignominious stare. There stood Hester, holding little Pearl by the hand, and there was the scarlet letter on her breast. The minister there made a pause, although the music still played the stately and rejoicing march to which the procession moved. It summoned him onward, onward to the festival. But here he made a pause. Bellingham, for the last few moments, had kept an anxious eye upon him. He now left his own place in the procession and advanced to give assistance, judging from Mr. Dimmesdale's aspect that he must otherwise inevitably fall. But there was something in the latter's expression that warned back the magistrate. Although a man not readily obeying the vague intimations that pass from one spirit to another. The crowd meanwhile looked on with awe and wonder. This earthly faintness was, in their view, only another phase of the minister's celestial strength. Nor would it have seemed a miracle too high to be wrought for one so holy, had he ascended before their eyes, waxing dimmer and brighter, and fading at last into the light of heaven. He turned towards the scaffold and stretched forth his arms. "Hester," said he, "come hither. Come, my little Pearl." It was a ghastly look with which he regarded them, but there was something at once tender and strangely triumphant in it. The child, with the bird-like motion which was one of her characteristics, flew to him and clasped her arms about his knees. Hester Prynne, slowly, as if impelled by inevitable fate, and against her strongest will, likewise drew near, but paused before she reached him. At this instant, old Roger Chillingworth thrust himself through the crowd, or perhaps so dark, disturbed, and evil was his look, he rose up out of some nether region to snatch back his victim from what he sought to do. Be that as it might, the old man rushed forward and caught the minister by the arm. "Madman, hold, what is your purpose?" whispered he. "Wave back that woman, cast off this child. All shall be well. Do not blacken your fame and perish in dishonor. I can yet save you. Would you bring infamy on your sacred profession?" "Ha, tempter, methinks thou art too late," answered the minister, encountering his eye fearfully but firmly. "Thy power is not what it was. With God's help I shall escape thee now." He again extended his hand to the woman of the scarlet letter. "Hester Prynne," cried he with a piercing earnestness, "in the name of him so terrible and so merciful, who gives me grace at this last moment to do what, for my own heavy sin and miserable agony, I withheld myself from doing 7 years ago, come hither now and twine thy strength about me. Thy strength, Hester, and let it be guided by the will which God hath granted me. This wretched and wronged old man is opposing it with all his might, with all his own might, and the fiend's. Come, Hester, come, support me up yonder scaffold." The crowd was in a tumult. The men of rank and dignity who stood more immediately around the clergyman were so taken by surprise and so perplexed as to the purport of what they saw, unable to receive the explanation which most readily presented itself, or to imagine any other, that they remained silent and inactive spectators of the judgment which Providence seemed about to work. They beheld the minister, leaning on Hester's shoulder and supported by her arm around him, approach the scaffold and ascend its steps, while still the little hand of the sin-born child was clasped in his. Old Roger Chillingworth followed, as one intimately connected with the drama of guilt and sorrow in which they had all been actors, and well entitled, therefore, to be present at its closing scene. "Hast thou sought the whole earth over?" said he, looking darkly at the clergyman. "There was no one place so secret, no high place nor lowly place, where thou couldst have escaped me, save on this very scaffold. Thanks be to him who hath led me hither, answered the minister. Yet he trembled and turned to Hester with an expression of doubt and anxiety in his eyes, not the less evidently betrayed that there was a feeble smile upon his lips. "Is not this better," murmured he, "than what we dreamed of in the forest?" "I know not, I know not," she hurriedly replied. "Better? Yea, so we may both die, and little Pearl die with us." "For thee and Pearl be it as God shall order," said the minister, "and God is merciful. Let me now do the will which he hath made plain before my sight. For Hester, I am a dying man, so let me make haste to take my shame upon me." Partly supported by Hester Prynne and holding one hand of little Pearl's, the Reverend Mr. Dimmesdale turned to the dignified and venerable rulers, to the holy ministers who were his brethren, to the people whose great heart was thoroughly appalled, yet overflowing with tearful sympathy, as knowing that some deep life matter, which, if full of sin, was full of anguish and repentance likewise, was now to be laid open to them. The sun, but little past its meridian, shone down upon the clergyman and gave a distinctness to his figure as he stood out from all the earth to put in his plea of guilty at the bar of eternal justice. "People of New England," cried he, with a voice that rose over them high, solemn and majestic, yet had always a tremor through it and sometimes a shriek, struggling up out of a fathomless depth of remorse and woe, "ye that have loved me, ye that have deemed me holy, behold me here, the one sinner of the world. At last, I stand upon the spot where 7 years since I should have stood, here with this woman, whose arm, more than the little strength wherewith I have crept hitherward, sustains me at this dreadful moment from groveling down upon my face. Lo, the scarlet letter which Hester wears! Ye have all shuddered at it. Wherever her walk hath been, wherever, so miserably burdened, she may have hoped to find repose, it hath cast a lurid gleam of awe and horrible repugnance round about her. But there stood one in the midst of you, at whose brand of sin and infamy ye have not shuddered." It seemed at this moment as if the minister must leave the remainder of his secret undisclosed, but he fought back the bodily weakness, and still more the faintness of heart, that was striving for the mastery with him. He threw off all assistance, and stepped passionately forward a pace before the woman and the child. "It was on him," he continued with a kind of fierceness, so determined was he to speak out the whole. "God's eye beheld it. The angels were forever pointing at it. The devil knew it well and fretted it continually with the touch of his burning finger. But he hid it cunningly from men and walked among you with the mien of a spirit mournful because so pure in a sinful world, and sad because he missed his heavenly kindred. Now at the death hour he stands up before you. He bids you look again at Hester's scarlet letter. He tells you that with all its mysterious horror, it is but the shadow of what he bears on his own breast, and that even this, his own red stigma, is no more than the type of what has seared his inmost heart. Stand any here that question God's judgment on a sinner. Behold, behold a dreadful witness of it." With a convulsive motion, he tore away the ministerial band from before his breast. It was revealed, but it were irreverent to describe that revelation. For an instant the gaze of the horror-stricken multitude was concentrated on the ghastly miracle, while the minister stood with a flush of triumph in his face, as one who in the crisis of acutest pain had won a victory. Then he sank upon the scaffold. Hester partly raised him, and supported his head against her bosom. Old Roger Chillingworth knelt down beside him with a blank, dull countenance, out of which the life seemed to have departed. "Thou hast escaped me," he repeated more than once. "Thou hast escaped me." "May God forgive thee," said the minister. "Thou, too, hast deeply sinned." He withdrew his dying eyes from the old man and fixed them on the woman and the child. "My little Pearl," said he feebly, and there was a sweet and gentle smile over his face, as of a spirit sinking into deep repose. Nay, now that the burden was removed, it seemed almost as if he would be sportive with the child. "Dear little Pearl, wilt thou kiss me now? Thou wouldst not yonder in the forest, but now thou wilt." Pearl kissed his lips. A spell was broken. The great scene of grief in which the wild infant bore a part had developed all her sympathies. And as her tears fell upon her father's cheek, they were the pledge that she would grow up amid human joy and sorrow, nor forever do battle with the world, but be a woman in it. Toward her mother, too, Pearl's errand as a messenger of anguish was all fulfilled. "Hester," said the clergyman, "farewell." "Shall we not meet again?" whispered she, bending her face down close to his. "Shall we not spend our immortal life together? Surely, surely, we have ransomed one another with all this woe. Thou lookest far into eternity, with those bright dying eyes. Then tell me what thou seest." "Hush, Hester, hush," said he, with tremulous solemnity. "The law we broke, the sin here so awfully revealed. Let these alone be in thy thoughts. I fear. It may be that when we forgot our God, when we violated our reverence each for the other's soul, it was thenceforth vain to hope that we could meet hereafter in an everlasting and pure reunion. God knows, and he is merciful. He hath proved his mercy most of all in my afflictions, by giving me this burning torture to bear upon my breast, by sending yonder dark and terrible old man to keep the torture always at red heat, by bringing me hither to die this death of triumphant ignominy before the people. Had either of these agonies been wanting, I had been lost forever. Praised be his name, his will be done. Farewell." That final word came forth with the minister's expiring breath. The multitude, silent till then, broke out in a strange, deep voice of awe and wonder, which could not as yet find utterance save in this murmur that rolled so heavily after the departed spirit. End of section 3. Section 4 of Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. Hepzibah Pynchon by Nathaniel Hawthorne. From the House of the Seven Gables. All this time, however, we are loitering faint-heartedly on the threshold of our story. In very truth, we have an invincible reluctance to disclose what Miss Hepzibah Pynchon was about to do. It has already been observed that in the basement story of the gable fronting on the street, an unworthy ancestor nearly a century ago had fitted up a shop. Ever since the old gentleman retired from trade and fell asleep under his coffin lid, not only the shop door, but the inner arrangements had been suffered to remain unchanged, while the dust of ages gathered inch deep over the shelves and counter, and partly filled an old pair of scales, as if it were of value enough to be weighed. It treasured itself up, too, in the half-open till, where there still lingered a base sixpence, worth neither more nor less than the hereditary pride, which had here been put to shame. Such had been the state and condition of the little shop in which old Hepzibah's childhood, when she and her brother used to play at hide-and-seek in its forsaken precincts. So it had remained until within a few days past. But now, though the shop window was still closely curtained from the public gaze, a remarkable change had taken place in its interior. The rich and heavy festoons of cobweb, which it had cost a long ancestral succession of spiders their life's labor to spin and weave, had been carefully brushed away from the ceiling. The counter, shelves, and floor had all been scoured, and the latter was overstrewn with fresh blue sand. The brown scales, too, had evidently undergone rigid discipline, in an unavailing effort to rub off the rust which, alas, had eaten through and through their substance. Neither was the little old shop any longer empty of merchantable goods. A curious eye, privileged to take an account and investigate behind the counter, would have discovered a barrel, yea, two or three barrels, and half ditto, one containing flour, another apples, and a third, perhaps, Indian meal. There was likewise a square box of pine wood full of soap and bars, also another the same size in which were tallow candles 10 to the pound, a small stock of brown sugar, some white beans and split peas, and a few other commodities of low price and such as are constantly in demand, made up the bulkier portion of the merchandise. It might have been taken for a ghostly or phantasmagoric reflection of the old shopkeeper Pynchon's shabbily provided shelves, save that some of the articles were of a description and outward form which could hardly have been known in his day. For instance, there was a glass pickle jar filled with fragments of Gibraltar rock, not indeed splinters of the veritable stone foundation of the famous fortress, but bits of delectable candy, neatly done up in white paper. Jim Crow, moreover, was seen executing his world-renowned dance in gingerbread. A party of leaden dragoons was galloping along one of the shelves, in equipments and uniform of modern cut, and there were some sugar figures, with no strong resemblance to the humanity of any epoch, but less unsatisfactorily representing our own fashions than those of 100 years ago. Another phenomenon, still more strikingly modern, was a package of Lucifer matches, which in old times would have been thought actually to borrow their instantaneous flame from the nether fires of Tophet. In short, to bring the matter at once to a point, it was incontrovertibly evident that somebody had taken the shop and fixtures of the long-retired and forgotten Mr. Pynchon, and was about to renew the enterprise of that departed worthy with a different set of customers. Who could this bold adventurer be? And of all the places in the world, why had he chosen the House of the Seven Gables as the scene of his commercial speculations? We returned to the elderly maiden. She at length withdrew her eyes from the dark countenance of the colonel's portrait, heaved a sigh, indeed her breast was a very cave of Aeolus that morning, and stepped across the room on tiptoe, as is the customary gait of elderly women. Passing through an intervening passage, she opened a door that communicated with the shop, just now so elaborately described. Owing to the projection of the upper story, and still more to the thick shadow of the Pynchon elm which stood almost directly in front of the gable, the twilight here was still as much akin to night as morning. Another heavy sigh for Miss Hepzibah. After a moment's pause on the threshold, peering towards the window with her nearsighted scowl, as if frowning down some bitter enemy, she suddenly projected herself into the shop. The haste, and as it were the galvanic impulse, of the movement was really quite startling. Nervously, in a sort of frenzy, we might almost say, she began to busy herself in arranging some children's playthings and other little wares on the shelves and at the shop window. In the aspect of this dark-arrayed, pale-faced, ladylike old figure, there was a deeply tragic character that contrasted irreconcilably with the ludicrous pettiness of her employment. It seemed a queer anomaly that so gaunt and dismal a personage should take a toy in hand. A miracle that the toy did not vanish in her grasp. A miserably absurd idea that she should go on perplexing her stiff and somber intellect with the question how to tempt little boys into her premises. Yet such is undoubtedly her object. Now she places a gingerbread elephant against the window, but with so tremulous a touch that it tumbles upon the floor, with the dismemberment of three legs and its trunk. It has ceased to be an elephant and has become a few bits of musty gingerbread. There again she has upset a tumbler of marbles, all of which roll different ways, and each individual marble, devil-directed, into the most difficult obscurity that it can find. Heaven help our poor old Hepzibah, and forgive us for taking a ludicrous view of her position. As her rigid and rusty frame goes down upon its hands and knees in quest of the absconding marbles, we positively feel so much the more inclined to shed tears of sympathy from the very fact that we must needs turn aside and laugh at her. For here, and if we fail to impress it suitably upon the reader, it is our own fault, not that of the theme, here is one of the truest points of melancholy interest that occur in ordinary life. It was the final throw of what called itself old gentility, a lady who had fed herself from childhood with the shadowy food of aristocratic reminiscences, and whose religion it was that a lady's hand soils itself irredeemably by doing aught for bread. This born lady, after 60 years of narrowing means, is fain to step down from her pedestal of imaginary rank. Poverty, treading closely at her heels for a lifetime, has come up with her at last. She must earn her own food or starve. And we have stolen upon Miss Hepzibah Pynchon, too irreverently, at the instant of time when the patrician lady is to be transformed into the plebeian woman. In this republican country, amid the fluctuating waves of our social life, somebody is always at the drowning point. The tragedy is enacted with as continual a repetition as that of a popular drama on a holiday, and nevertheless is felt as deeply, perhaps, as when a hereditary noble sinks below his order. More deeply, since with us rank is the grosser substance of wealth and a splendid establishment, and has no spiritual existence after the death of these, but dies hopelessly along with them. And therefore, since we have been unfortunate enough to introduce our heroine at so inauspicious a juncture, we would entreat for a mood of due solemnity, and the spectators of her fate. Let us behold in poor Hepzibah the immemorial lady, 200 years old on this side of the water, and thrice as many on the other, with her antique portraits, pedigrees, coats of arms, records, and traditions, and her claim as joint heiress to that princely territory at the eastward, no longer a wilderness, but a populous fertility, born to in Pynchon Street, under the Pynchon Elm, and in the Pynchon House, where she has spent all her days, reduced now in that very house to be the huckstress of a scent shop. This business of setting up a petty shop is almost the only resource of women in circumstances at all similar to those of our unfortunate recluse. With her nearsightedness and those tremulous fingers of hers, at once inflexible and delicate, she could not be a seamstress, although her sampler, 50 years gone by, exhibited some of the most recondite specimens of ornamental needlework. A school for little children had been often in her thoughts, and at one time she had begun a review of her early studies in the New England Primer, with a view to prepare herself for the office of instructress. But the love of children had never been quickened in Hepzibah's heart, and was now torpid if not extinct. She watched the little people of the neighborhood from her chamber window and doubted whether she could tolerate a more intimate acquaintance with them. Besides, in our day, the very ABC has become a science, greatly too abstruse to be any longer taught by pointing a pen from letter to letter. A modern child could teach old Hepzibah more than old Hepzibah could teach the child. So with many a cold, deep heartquake at the idea of, at last, coming into sordid contact with the world, from which she had been so long kept aloof, while every added day of seclusion had rolled another stone against the cavern door of her hermitage, the poor thing bethought herself of the ancient shop window, the rusty scales, and the dusty till. She might have held back a little longer, but another circumstance not yet hinted at had somewhat hastened her decision. Her humble preparations, therefore, were duly made, and the enterprise was now to be commenced. Nor was she entitled to complain of any remarkable singularity in her fate, for in the town of her nativity we might point to several little shops of a similar description, some of them in houses as ancient as that of the Seven Gables, and one or two, it may be, where a decayed gentlewoman stands behind the counter, as grim an image of family pride as Miss Hepzibah Pynchon herself. It was overpoweringly ridiculous, we must honestly confess it, the deportment of the maiden lady while setting her shop in order for the public eye. She stole on tiptoe to the window as cautiously as if she conceived some bloody-minded villain to be watching behind the elm tree with intent to take her life. Stretching out her long, lank arm, she put a paper of pearl buttons, a jew's harp, and whatever the small article might be, in its destined place, and straightway vanished back into the dusk, as if the world need never hope for another glimpse of her. It might have been fancied, indeed, that she expected to minister to the wants of the community unseen, like a disembodied divinity or enchantress holding forth her bargains to the reverential and awe-stricken purchaser in an invisible hand. But Hepzibah had no such flattering dream. She was well aware that she must ultimately come forward and stand revealed in her proper individuality. And like other sensitive persons, she could not bear to be observed in the gradual process, and chose rather to flash forth on the world's astonished gaze at once. The inevitable moment was not much longer to be delayed. The sunshine might now be seen stealing down the front of the opposite house, from the windows of which came a reflected gleam, struggling through the boughs of the elm tree, and enlightening the interior of the shop more distinctly than heretofore. The town appeared to be waking up. A baker's cart had already rattled through the street, chasing away the latest vestige of night's sanctity, with the jingle-jangle of its dissonant bells. A milkman was distributing the contents of his cans from door to door, and the harsh peal of a fisherman's conch shell was heard far off around the corner. None of these tokens escaped Hepzibah's notice. The moment had arrived. To delay longer would only be to lengthen out her misery. Nothing remained except to take down the bar from the shop door, leaving the entrance free. More than free. Welcome. As if all were household friends to every passerby whose eyes might be attracted by the commodities of the window. This last act Hepzibah now performed, letting the bar fall with what smote upon her excited nerves as a most astounding clatter. Then, as if the only barrier betwixt herself and the world had been thrown down, and a flood of evil consequences would come tumbling through the gap, she fled into the inner parlor, threw herself into the ancestral elbow chair, and wept. Our miserable old Hepzibah. It is a heavy annoyance to a writer who endeavors to represent nature, its various attitudes and circumstances, in a reasonably correct outline and true coloring, that so much of the mean and ludicrous should be hopelessly mixed up with the purest pathos which life anywhere supplies to him. What tragic dignity, for example, can be wrought into a scene like this? How can we elevate our history of retribution for the sin of long ago, when, as one of our most prominent figures, we are compelled to introduce, not as a young and lovely woman, nor even the stately remains of beauty, storm-shattered by affliction, but a gaunt, sallow, rusty-jointed maiden, in a long-waisted silk gown, and with the strange horror of a turban on her head. Her visage is not even ugly. It is redeemed from insignificance only by the contraction of her eyebrows into a nearsighted scowl. And finally, her great life trial seems to be that, after 60 years of idleness, she finds it convenient to earn comfortable bread by setting up a shop in a small way. Nevertheless, if we look through all the heroic fortunes of mankind, we shall find this same entanglement of something mean and trivial with whatever is noblest in joy or sorrow. Life is made up of marble and mud, and without all the deeper trust in a comprehensive sympathy above us, we might hence be led to suspect the insult of a sneer, as well as an immitigable frown, on the iron countenance of fate. What is called poetic insight is the gift of discerning, in this sphere of strangely mingled elements, the beauty and the majesty which are compelled to assume a garb so sordid. End of section 4. Section 5 of Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. The Old Manse by Nathaniel Hawthorne. From Mosses from an Old Manse. Between two tall gateposts of rough-hewn stone, the gate itself having fallen from its hinges at some unknown epoch, we beheld the gray front of the old parsonage terminating the vista of an avenue of black ash trees. It was now a twelvemonth since the funeral procession of the venerable clergyman, its last inhabitant, had turned from that gateway toward the village burying ground. The wheel track leading to the door, as well as the whole breadth of the avenue, was almost overgrown with grass, affording dainty mouthfuls to two or three vagrant cows, and an old white horse who had his own living to pick up along the roadside. The glimmering shadows that lay half asleep between the door of the house and the public highway were a kind of spiritual medium, seen through which the edifice had not quite the aspect of belonging to the material world. Certainly it had little in common with those ordinary abodes, which stand so eminent upon the road that every passer-by can thrust his head, as it were, into the domestic circle. From these quiet windows, the figures of passing travelers looked too remote and dim to disturb the sense of privacy. In its near retirement and accessible seclusion, it was the very spot for the residence of a clergyman, a man not estranged from human life, yet enveloped, in the midst of it, with a veil woven of intermingled gloom and brightness. It was worthy to have been one of the time-honored parsonages of England, in which through many generations a succession of holy occupants passed from youth to age, and bequeath each an inheritance of sanctity, to pervade the house and hover over it, as with an atmosphere. Nor, in truth, had the old manse ever been profaned by a lay occupant, until that memorable summer afternoon when I entered it as my house. A priest had built it, a priest had succeeded to it, other priestly men from time to time had dwelt in it, and children born in his chambers and grown up to assume the priestly character. It was awful to reflect how many sermons must have been written there. The latest inhabitant alone, he by whose translation to paradise the dwelling was left vacant, had penned nearly 3,000 discourses, besides the better if not the greater number that gushed living from his lips. How often, no doubt, had he paced to and fro along the avenue, attuning his meditations to the sighs and gentle murmurs and deep and solemn peals of the wind among the tops of the lofty trees. In that variety of natural utterances, he could find something accordant with every passage of his sermon, were it of tenderness or reverential fear. The boughs over my head seemed shadowy with solemn thoughts, as well as with rustling leaves. I took shame to myself for having been so long a writer of idle stories, and ventured to hope that wisdom would descend upon me with the falling leaves of the avenue, and that I should light upon an intellectual treasure in the old manse, well worth those hoards of long-hidden gold which people seek for in moss-grown houses. profound treatises of morality, a layman's unprofessional and therefore unprejudiced views of religion, history such as Bancroft might have written had he taken up his abode here, as he once purposed, bright with picture, gleaming over a depth of philosophic thought. These were the works that might fitly have flowed from such a retirement. In the humblest event, I resolved at least to achieve a novel that should evolve some deep lesson and should possess physical substance enough to stand alone. The study had three windows set with little old-fashioned panes of glass, each with a crack across it. The two at the western side looked, or rather peeped, between the willow branches down into the orchard, with glimpses of the river through the trees. The third, facing northward, commanded a broader view of the river at a spot where its hitherto obscure waters gleamed forth into the light of history. It was at this window that the clergyman who then dwelt in the manse stood watching the outbreak of a long and deadly struggle between two nations. He saw the irregular array of his parishioners on the farther side of the river and the glittering line of the British on the hither bank. He awaited in an agony of suspense the rattle of the musketry. It came, and there needed but a gentle wind to sweep the battle smoke around this quiet house. A youth in the service of the clergyman happened to be chopping wood that April morning at the back door of the manse, and when the noise of battle rang from side to side of the bridge, he hastened across the intervening field to see what might be going forward. It is rather strange, by the way, that this lad should have been so diligently at work when the whole population of town and country were startled out of their customary business by the advance of the British troops. Be that as it might, the tradition says that the lad had now left his task and hurried to the battlefield with the axe still in his hand. The British had by this time retreated. The Americans were in pursuit, and the late scene of strife was thus deserted by both parties. Two soldiers lay on the ground. One was a corpse. But as the young New Englander drew nigh, the other Briton raised himself painfully upon his hands and knees and gave a ghastly stare into his face. The boy, it must have been a nervous impulse without purpose, without thought, and betokening a sensitive and impressionable nature rather than a hardened one, the boy uplifted his axe and dealt the wounded soldier a fierce and fatal blow upon the head. I could wish that the grave might be opened, for I would fain know whether either of the skeleton soldiers has the mark of an axe on his skull. The story comes home to me like truth. Oftentimes, as an intellectual and moral exercise, I have sought to follow that poor youth through his subsequent career, and observe how his soul was tortured by the bloodstain, contracted as it had been, before the long custom of war had robbed human life of its sanctity, and while it still seemed murderous to slay a brother man. This one circumstance has borne more fruit for me than all that history tells us of the fight. When summer was dead and buried, the old manse became as lonely as a hermitage. Not that ever, in my time at least, it had been thronged with company. But at no rare intervals we welcomed some friend out of the dusty glare and tumult of the world, and rejoiced to share with him the transparent obscurity that was floating over us. In one respect, our precincts were like the enchanted ground through which the pilgrim traveled on his way to the celestial city. The guests, each and all, felt a slumberous influence upon them. They fell asleep in chairs or took a more deliberate siesta on the sofa, and were seen stretched among the shadows of the orchard, looking up dreamily through the boughs. They could not have paid a more acceptable compliment to my abode, nor to my own qualities as a host. I held it as a proof that they left their cares behind them as they passed between the stone gateposts at the entrance of our avenue, and that the so powerful opiate was the abundance of peace and quiet within and all around us. Others could give them pleasures and amusement or instruction. These could be picked up anywhere. But it was for me to give them rest, rest in a life of trouble. What better could be done for those weary and world-worn spirits? For him whose career of perpetual action was impeded and harassed by the rarest of his powers and the richest of his acquirements. For another who had thrown his ardent heart from earliest youth into the strife of politics and now, perchance, began to suspect that one lifetime is too brief for the accomplishment of any lofty aim. For her, on whose feminine nature had been imposed the heavy gift of intellectual power, such as a strong man might have staggered under, and with it the necessity to act upon the world. In a word, not to multiply instances, what better could be done for anybody who came within our magic circle than to throw the spell of a tranquil spirit over him, and when it had wrought its full effect, Then we dismissed him with but misty reminiscences, as if he had been dreaming of us. These hobgoblins of flesh and blood were attracted thither by the widespreading influence of a great original thinker, who had his earthly abode at the opposite extremity of our village. His mind acted upon other minds of a certain constitution with wonderful magnetism, and drew many men upon long pilgrimages to speak with him face to face. Young visionaries to whom just so much of insight had been imparted as to make life all a labyrinth around them came to seek the clue that could guide them out of their self-involved bewilderment. Gray-headed theorists, whose systems at first air had finally imprisoned them in an iron framework, traveled painfully to his door, not to ask deliverance, but to invite the free spirit into their own thraldom. People that had lighted on a new thought, or a thought they fancied new, came to Emerson, as the finder of a glistening gem hastens to a lapidary to ascertain its quality and value. Uncertain, troubled, earnest wanderers through the midnight of a moral world beheld its intellectual fire as a beacon burning on a hilltop, and climbing the difficult ascent, looked forth into the surrounding obscurity more hopefully than hitherto. The light revealed objects unseen before, mountains, gleaming lakes, glimpses of a creation among the chaos, but also, as was unavoidable, it attracted bats and owls and the whole host of night birds, who flapped their dusky wings against the gazer's eyes and sometimes were mistaken for fowls of angelic feather. Such delusions always hover nigh whenever a beacon fire of truth is kindled. For myself, there have been epochs of my life when I, too, might have asked of this prophet the master word that should solve me the riddle of the universe. But now, being happy, I felt as if there were no question to be put, and therefore admired Emerson as a poet of deep beauty and austere tenderness, but sought nothing from him as a philosopher. It was good, nevertheless, to meet him in the wood paths, or sometimes in our avenue, with that pure intellectual gleam diffused about his presence, like the garment of a shining one. And he so quiet, so simple, so without pretension, encountering each man alike, as if expecting to receive more than he could impart. And in truth, the heart of many an ordinary man had, perchance, inscriptions which he could not read. But it was impossible to dwell in his vicinity without inhaling more or less the mountain atmosphere of his lofty thought, which in the brains of some people wrought a singular giddiness, new truth being as heady as new wine. Never was a poor little country village infested with such a variety of queer, strangely dressed, oddly behaved mortals, most of whom took upon themselves to be important agents of the world's destiny, yet were simply bores of a very intense water. Such, I imagine, is the invariable character of persons who crowd so closely about an original thinker as to draw in his unuttered breath, and thus to become imbued with a false originality. The triteness of novelty is enough to make any man of common sense blaspheme at all ideas of less than a century standing, and pray that the world may be petrified and rendered immovable in precisely the worst moral and physical state that it ever yet arrived at, rather than be benefited by such schemes of such philosophers. Glancing back over what I have written, it seems but the scattered reminiscences of a single summer. In fairyland there is no measurement of time, and in a spot so sheltered from the turmoil of life's ocean, 3 years hasten away with a noiseless flight, as the breezy sunshine chases the cloud shadows across the depths of a still valley. Now came hints, growing more and more distinct, that the owner of the old house was pining for his native air. Carpenters next appeared, making a tremendous racket among the outbuildings, strewing the green grass with pine shavings and chips of chestnut joists, and vexing the whole antiquity of the place with their discordant renovations. Soon, moreover, they divested our abode of the veil of woodbine which had crept over a large portion of its southern face. All the aged mosses were cleared unsparingly away, and there were horrible whispers about brushing up the external walls with a coat of paint. A purpose as little to my taste as might be that of rouging the venerable cheeks of one's grandmother, but the hand that renovates is always more sacrilegious than that which destroys. In fine, we gathered up our household goods, drank a farewell cup of tea in our pleasant little breakfast room, delicately fragrant tea, an unpurchasable luxury, one of the many angel gifts that had fallen like dew upon us, and passed forth between the tall stone gateposts, as uncertain as the wandering Arabs, where our tent might next be pitched. Providence took me by the hand, and, an oddity of dispensation which I trust, there is no irreverence in smiling at, has led me, as the newspapers announce, while I am writing from the old manse, into a custom house. As a storyteller, I have often contrived strange vicissitudes for my imaginary personages, but none like this. End of section 5. Section 6 of Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 18. The Faun's Transformation by Nathaniel Hawthorne. From The Marble Faun. The door of the courtyard swung slowly and closed itself of its own accord. Miriam and Donatello were now alone there. She clasped her hands and looked wildly at the young man, whose form seemed to have dilated, and whose eyes blazed with the fierce energy that had suddenly inspired him. It had kindled him into a man. It had developed within him an intelligence which was no native characteristic of the Donatello whom we have heretofore known, but that simple and joyous creature was gone forever. "What have you done?" said Miriam in a horror-stricken whisper. The glow of rage was still lurid on Donatello's face and now flashed out again from his eyes. "I did what ought to be done to a traitor," he replied. "I did what your eyes bade me do, when I asked them with mine, as I held the wretch over the precipice." These last words struck Miriam like a bullet. Could it be so? Had her eyes provoked or assented to this deed? She had not known it, but alas, looking back into the frenzy and turmoil of the scene just acted, she could not deny, she was not sure whether it might be so or no, that a wild joy had flamed up in her heart when she beheld her persecutor in his mortal peril. Was it horror or ecstasy, or both in one? Be the emotion what it might, it had blazed up more madly when Donatello flung his victim off the cliff, and more while his shriek went quivering downward. With the dead thump upon the stones below had come an unutterable horror. "And my eyes bade you do it," repeated she. They both leaned over the parapet and gazed downward as earnestly, as if some inestimable treasure had fallen over and were yet recoverable. On the pavement below was a dark mass lying in a heap, with little or nothing human in its appearance, except that the hands were stretched out, as if they might have clutched for a moment at the small square stones. But there was no motion in them now. Miriam watched the heap of mortality, while she could count 100, which she took pains to do. No stir, not a finger moved. "You have killed him, Donatello. He is quite dead," said she. "Stone dead. Would I were so too." "Did you not mean that he should die?" sternly asked Donatello, still in the glow of that intelligence which passion had developed in him. There was short time to weigh the matter, but he had his trial in that breath or two while I held him over the cliff, and his sentence in that one glance when your eyes responded to mine. Say that I have slain him against your will. Say that he died without your whole consent, and in another breath you shall see me lying beside him." "Oh, never," cried Miriam, "my one own friend, never, never, never." She turned to him, the guilty, blood-stained, lonely woman. She turned to her fellow criminal, the youth so lately innocent, whom she had drawn into her doom. She pressed him close, close to her bosom, with a clinging embrace that brought their two hearts together, till the horror and agony of each was combined into one emotion, and that a kind of rapture. "Yes, Donatello, you speak the truth," said she. "My heart consented to what you did. We two slew yonder wretch. The deed knots us together for time and eternity like the coil of a serpent." They threw one other glance at the heap of death below to assure themselves that it was there, so like a dream was the whole thing. Then they turned from that fatal precipice and came out of the courtyard, arm in arm, heart in heart. Instinctively, they were heedful not to sever themselves so much as a pace or two from one another, for fear of the terror and deadly chill that would thenceforth wait for them in solitude. Their deed, the crime which Donatello wrought, and Miriam accepted on the instant, had wreathed itself, as she said, like a serpent in inextricable links about both their souls and drew them into one by its terrible contractile power. It was closer than a marriage bond, so intimate in those first moments was the union, that it seemed as if their new sympathy annihilated all other ties, and that they were released from the chain of humanity. A new sphere, a special law, had been created for them alone. The world could not come near them. They were safe. When they reached the flight of stairs leading downward from the capital, There was a far-off noise of singing and laughter. Swift indeed had been the rush of the crisis that was come and gone. This was still the merriment of the party that had so recently been their companions. They recognized the voices which, a little while ago, had accorded and sung in cadence with their own. But they were familiar voices no more. They sounded strangely, and as it were out of the depths of space. So remote was all that pertained to the past life of these guilty ones, in the moral seclusion that had suddenly extended itself around them. But how close and ever closer did the breadth of the immeasurable waste that lay between them and all brotherhood or sisterhood now press them one within the other. "O friend," cried Miriam, so putting her soul into the word that it took a heavy richness of meaning and seemed never to have been spoken before. "O friend, are you conscious, as I am, of this companionship that knits our heartstrings together?" "I feel it, Miriam," said Donatello. "We draw one breath, we live one life." "Only yesterday," continued Miriam, "nay, only a short half-hour ago, I shivered in an icy solitude. No friendship, no sisterhood, could come near enough to keep the warmth within my heart. In an instant all is changed. There can be no more loneliness." "None, Miriam," said Donatello. "None, my beautiful one," responded Miriam, gazing in his face, which had taken a higher, almost an heroic aspect from the strength of passion. "None, my innocent one. Surely it is no crime that we have committed. One wretched and worthless life has been sacrificed to cement two other lives forevermore." "Forevermore, Miriam," said Donatello, "cemented with his blood." The young man started at the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.